We're going to read from the Bible this morning, from Nehemiah chapter 4. And you'll notice that if you're using the bulletin that we put online on 10th.org/worship, that we've included the whole chapter. And obviously that was when I was feeling optimistic earlier in the week. So we're only going to read a few of the verses this morning, verses 1 to 3. That's as far as I got. So let's hear the word of God then, from Nehemiah chapter 4 and verse 1. Now when Sanballat heard that we were building the wall, he was angry and greatly enraged, and he jeered at the Jews. And he said in the presence of his brothers and of the army of Samaria, "What are these feeble Jews doing? Will they restore it for themselves? Will they sacrifice? Will they finish up in a day? Will they revive the stones out of the heaps of the rubbish, and burned ones at that?" Tobiah the Ammonite was beside him, and he said, "Yes, what are they building? If a fox goes up on it, he will break down their stone wall." This is the word of the Lord. When the Lord Jesus said, "I will build my church," he was reassuring us that his church would be built and finally completed, that the New Jerusalem would with certainty come down out of heaven from God, beautiful as a bride ready for her wedding, and mighty as an army with banners. When Jesus added the words, "And the gates of hell shall not prevail against it," he was reminding us that between this day and that day, we will encounter resistance, steady resistance, from the devil and all his works, but that no weapon formed against us will succeed. Now that normative word of Jesus is very important for our understanding of this text today, because it sheds light on the meaning of the text for us where we are in the flow of biblical history. Let me remind you about the flow of Nehemiah so far. Nehemiah has come from Babylon with letters from the king of Persia, and his job has been to rebuild the city of Jerusalem. Chapter 3 was a summary chapter. What chapter 3 told us was they began building and they finished building. The battlements and the gates of Jerusalem were going to be built and completed. And we saw the reason for that is for the coming of the Messiah, ultimately. This is the Jerusalem, these are the streets, these are the walls, these are the gates through which the Messiah will walk, on which the Messiah will climb, and through which gates the Messiah will enter the city of Jerusalem. This has to happen in the big plan of God, because Messiah will come and reveal himself in Jerusalem to his own people, the Jews. And that's significant. And it puts what's happening in chapter 12 in perspective. This is not just opposition from the neighbors to some building work that's going on. You may have had the experience of doing some building work in your house and your neighbors have opposed it and they've complained about it. They may have written to your town or city council and told them that they were annoyed about what you were doing. This is not that. This is the gates of hell. And behind these individuals that we're going to read about is our ancient foe, who the Bible says is called the devil and Satan. Because the fact of the matter is that behind every form of human resistance to the work of God and the will of God, there is spiritual warfare. That behind every opponent, every critic, every grumbler, everyone who resists the work of God, the spiritual work of God in the church of God, behind every one of those lies the adversary, this malignant operator who opposes Christ and his church. Because Satan is the ultimate enemy of the church of God. Satan hates God as the creator. In the Bible, Satan is described as a destroyer and a deceiver and a liar and a murderer and an accuser and a slanderer and a usurper. He is the God of this age, or he likes to parade around as if he were. And wherever God is at work, you can be sure Satan will be nearby. Because he hates God, he hates humans, and he hates all that God has made, and he especially hates the people of God, the Israel of God, the church of God. He thrives in heresy and lies and gossip and slander and whispering campaigns. He thinks and speaks and plans evil against God himself, against humanity generally, and against the church in particular. And so wherever there is a work of God being done, Satan and his minions are always there or thereabouts. That is the significance of this chapter. With that in mind, then, I want to talk about two things this morning. I want to talk about the enemy and the enmity, the enemy and the enmity that we find illustrated in this passage before us today. First of all, the enemy. Now, you may notice as you read the passage that there are actually three people involved in this passage: Sanballat, Tobiah, and Geshem the Arab. But I want to talk about the enemy behind these people. First of all, Satan himself. Because Satan is at work in the world. We see him, sometimes we see him in the Bible personally present. You go back to the Garden of Eden, and he is personally present to Eve in the guise of a talking serpent. The devil is there in the guise of that serpent, speaking to her, deceiving her, drawing her into sin. Then there's Jesus. Jesus, you remember, after he's baptized by John, is led by the Holy Spirit into the desert, and there he is tempted in the wilderness. Just as Israel was tested and tempted in the wilderness, so now Jesus, the new Israel, is tested and tempted by the devil. Just as Adam, in a garden, but now Jesus in a wilderness, the result of Adam's disobedience is that the earth is a wilderness in many parts. Now Jesus, as the second Adam and the last Adam, is tempted and tested by the devil himself personally. Now, I really don't expect you or I to be important enough to be tempted and tested by the devil himself personally. He is an angel. He's a spirit being. But Satan can only be in one place at one time, as every angel can be. So Satan has this great one-third of the heavenly host who are angels who are able to work on and to assault the individual child of God. But behind them is Satan himself. So in the world in which we live, and in our daily lives, and in the lives of our churches, where will we see Satan at work? Well, we will see Satan at work mostly through people. Satan works through people. Now you may think, well, I've known some people in my life who were so bad, so wicked, that they were obviously the instruments of Satan. And that is true. I'm sure many of us can think of people. We can certainly see people in the history of the world whose actions and attitudes and behaviors and the damage they have done to the human race is definitely evidence of the work of Satan. But remember Jesus. You remember that occasion when Jesus speaks to the apostle Peter. Peter, who has been the great confessor of Christ. Peter, whom he has called the rock on which he will build his church. And when Peter, as close as he was to the Master, as important he is in the history of the church, when Peter tries to dissuade Jesus from going to the cross, Jesus says to Peter, "Get behind me, Satan." And we learn from that that Satan works in the world through people. Good people and bad people. Christian people as well as non-Christian people. Apparently, even believers can be the unwitting instruments in Satan's arsenal. Now, here in Nehemiah chapter 4, then, we're introduced to three of Satan's little helpers: Sanballat, Tobiah, and Geshem. Back in chapter 2, verse 10, we were introduced to this triumvirate, and we were told there that Sanballat and Tobiah were greatly disturbed that someone had come to seek the welfare of the people of Israel. That's what got up their nose. And Nehemiah had responded at that time to their verbal assault and said this to those men. He said this: "You have no portion or right or claim in Jerusalem." No portion or right or claim in Jerusalem. Now, this building project that Nehemiah was engaged in, and these earthly efforts of the men and women who built or rebuilt the city of Jerusalem, were going to prepare the way for the coming of the Messiah. But that was only a stepping stone to God's larger purpose, which was to build New Jerusalem, the bride of Christ, which would not just be for Jews alone, but for Jews and Gentiles, this international, multiracial company of people who call on the name of the Lord Jesus for salvation. But here's the thing. Only those who value Israel's Messiah, only those who come to Israel's Messiah and who receive him as their Savior, only those know ultimately the forgiveness of their sins. Only those are made kings and priests to God. Only those have a portion and a right and a claim to the heavenly Jerusalem, the new Jerusalem. For only those have their names written in the Lamb's Book of Life. So, what this chapter is talking about in its bigger picture, the building of Jerusalem, is pointing us to the building of the new Jerusalem, and it's pointing us to the Church of God, who is the Bride of Christ, and is the new Jerusalem. And God is doing a work in the world that has this long-term perspective. And only those of you who have trusted in Jesus, trusted in the Messiah of Israel, only those who are looking to him for your salvation and to him alone will have a part in that new Jerusalem. And Nehemiah is saying to these men, you have no portion or right or claim in the heavenly Jerusalem. And that's because this triumvirate were resolutely opposed to the work of God. In fact, back in chapter 2, verse 19, we read that they jeered at us and despised us and said, quote, "What are you doing? Are you rebelling against the king?" Not only were they being contemptuous of the Jews as they thought about rebuilding their city, but they were accusing him, or they were implying that they were disobeying the law. And in their language, do you notice the implicit threat of legal action? If they were breaking the law, these would be the people who would take them to court and would bring the action against them before the Persian king. Now, that's the background then to what we read in chapter 4. When we come to chapter 4, we find in verse 7 that they were very angry. And we find in verse 8 that they all plotted to come and fight against Jerusalem and to cause confusion in it. And behind their behaviors, we catch a glimpse of some of Satan's strategies. And one thing is very clear: the enemy, Satan, is driven by anger against the people of God. He hates the church of God. He is roaming around the world like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. And just as the very thought of building Zion made these men angry and greatly enraged and very angry, as the text says, so Satan, who stands behind them and whose instruments they are, is angry and very angry and greatly enraged by the rise and the progress of the gospel in the world today. I want you to look at these enemies for a moment. They're Sanballat. Sanballat's a Babylonian name, although he comes from an area about 18 miles northeast of Jerusalem, the area of Samaria. We know this, that about 38 years later, from the point that we are reading about 38 years later from this period of time, he was going to be the governor of Samaria. We know that from the year 407 BC. Now, that information and what we learn from the text of Nehemiah suggests that here is a man who is, he believes in the God of Israel, but he doesn't believe in God working through the tribe of Judah. He's a Samaritan, after all. He has Samaritan religion, which is nearly orthodox. He rejects all of the prophets. He rejects the promise of the Messiah that will come from the tribe of Judah and the house of David. So he has a modicum of understanding of at least the Pentateuch, the first five books of the Old Testament. But his goal, it seems, is to become governor of Samaria. Now that helps us to understand, I think, something of this man's character. He is a political animal, determined to advance his career. He wants his people to support him, and they will support him if he is against this intrusion of Jewish, particularly Jewish religious views. He wanted to keep in with his political masters at all costs. He didn't hesitate for one minute to publicly question Nehemiah's motives, to publicly suggest that he was a subversive figure out to get power for himself. And he was a bully. Did you notice that in verse 2? He doesn't come up to Nehemiah and have a little one-to-one chat. He will not speak face-to-face with Nehemiah. No, no. What he has to say, he will only say in the presence of his brothers and of the army of Samaria. That's the way bullies often behave. He's a subversive figure. You know, it's the way of bullies to accuse other people of bullying. It is the mark of the greedy and the ambitious that they are quick to accuse other people of being greedy or ambitious. And to Sanballat and to others, the idea that someone would serve God in an entirely disinterested way would never occur to them. Sanballat's a figure we meet today. Then Tobiah. Well, Tobiah, his name is a confession of faith. His name means the Lord, that is Yahweh, is good. It's a Jewish name. He married into a very well-known and influential Jewish family, priestly family. He belonged, therefore, to the aristocracy of the region. Amnon, next door to Judah, was the sphere of his operations. But whatever faith he had, whatever Jewish faith he had, was subservient to his own self-interest. He was a pragmatist. He would make sure that he was on the right side of history, and right now, history was on the side of those who were part of this great confederacy allied against the work that was going on in Jerusalem. Thirdly, there's this man, Geshem, the Arab. We know from history that Geshem the Arab and his son ruled over a league of Arabian tribes that took control of the south and the east of Judah, as well as parts of Arabia going right down towards the Gulf Coast and towards Egypt. He was at this time, of course, a pagan, and he was the most powerful of the three. He had the largest army of the three. Now, what is the commonality of these three? He is an outright pagan, a compromised believer, and a political operator. What drew them together? What drew them together was this, that they were united in the conviction that they needed to stop God from being glorified. We see this, don't we? All around us. Christians seem to be a threat, or Orthodox Christians seem to be a threat to the order loved by bureaucrats, or to the inclusiveness loved by the nominal Christian, or to the secularism loved by the pagan. In the words of Jesus, with which we began, all opposition to Christ's church is engineered by hell. Your adversary, the devil, goes around like a roaring lion seeking whom he may devour. The enemy, Satan, uses human instruments to achieve his purposes. But then secondly, I want you to notice the enmity now, looking at the actual assault as it begins. And you notice in verse 2, it begins with a show of force, an attempt in intimidation. In the presence of his brothers, the army of Samaria, he comes and he voices his questions to the air. Again, like any bully, he's not looking at the guy at Nehemiah or at the people eyeball to eyeball. He's talking to his crowd, but he's talking loud enough within the safety of his crowd about the things that he wants to say. That's what he's doing here. Bullies act like that. They need their gang, their audience, before they will speak their mind. Well, this man does that. And he displays his naked fury by asking these five questions. These questions were meant to make the Jews look bad. They were meant to rubbish the Jews. They were meant to undermine the morale of the people. They were meant to make people feel that they were useless and bring an end to this great project of rebuilding the city of God. And yet, as very often happens, buried within their words is the answer to the purposes of God and things that are important to us to learn and to grasp in these days. Let's look at the questions one by one. There's five of them. The first is, I think, the longest. Question one, what are these feeble Jews doing? Now, some recent scholars have pointed out that the Hebrew word for feeble here is a word used in Scripture to denote a withering plant or a hopeless people. So, for example, in Isaiah, we read this, the world languishes and the heavens languish. In both cases, this word, feeble. Or in Hosea 4, the land mourns and all who dwell in it languish. That is, they're enfeebled by it. This is the language that was used of Pharaoh when he's looking at the Jews, who are there acting as slaves in Egypt and under his control. What are these feeble Jews doing? Here they are, they're not military strong. They're in subjection to a foreign power. They have no independent status of their own. They're nothing on the world stage. They're no one. And yet, isn't it true that in the history that's recorded in Scripture, and in the history we observe as we look over the time, the last 2,000 years, or the last 5,000 years in the story of redemption, what do we see? We see that God, that is the mighty God who made the universe, very often delights to use the feeble and the frail. You remember the story of Eli. Eli was the chief priest. He was the head of a powerful priestly family. He was the most outstanding figure in Israel of his day. He was the judge of Israel. But when God came to speak, he did not go to Eli. He went to the boy, maybe about 12 years of age, 11 or 12 years of age, Samuel. And old Eli was not a very godly man, but he was godly enough to know that when this voice recurred again and again and again in the experience of this boy, that the boy should go back and say, "Speak, Lord, your servant heareth." God did not come to the priests and the powerful. He came to this boy. That's the way God operates. And when he was an old man, Samuel went to anoint Israel's new king. And he looked at all the brothers. He was led to the house of Jesse, and Jesse had sons. And he looked at all these men, fine strapping men, muscular and impressive men. And God whispers in Samuel's ear, "Do not look on their appearance or on the height of his stature, for the Lord sees not as man sees." For God dismisses all of those other brothers and focuses on David as the one that he would use. And it's as a youth that David is called on to act for Israel as her mediator, champion, and deliverer. Or take the story of Elijah. Remember when Elijah's there before the prophets of Baal, and he goes through that great period where he confronts them and he stands for God, and it's Elijah against the world. And he's bold and he's strong when he's standing for God in that great moment. And the fire comes down and falls and consumes the water that's been poured over his sacrifice as a demonstration of the power of God using Elijah. Fast forward a couple of days, and he's run away. He's hiding. He's exhausted. And he's stressed out. And he's near having a breakdown. God has to come to him and give him some food. Comes as the angel of the Lord, cooks him some food, gives him food to eat, tells him to take a nap and recover. You see, God is in the business of using the weak. Even though Israel and Samuel and David and Elijah were weak people, they did not fail ultimately. Why? Because Jesus said, "I will build my church." When the greatest crisis that has ever faced the human race occurred, the crisis between heaven and earth, and it's played out in history, it is the divine human protagonist who is the weakest. Isaiah the prophet puts it like this: "Who has believed our report? For he shall grow up before him like a tender plant and like a root out of dry ground. He has no form or comeliness that we should look at him, no beauty that we should desire him. He is despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief, and as one from whom men hide their faces. He was despised, and we esteemed him not." It is through this feeble Jew that salvation comes for the world. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, and we esteemed him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. These three, and those who join them, have always underestimated God's church. It's this crucified Messiah that's a stumbling block to the intellectuals, utter foolishness to others. This one, none of the rulers of this age understood him. But it's this crucified Messiah who is the weakness of God. The weakness of God is stronger than men. Or consider this: how does God work in the world today? He works through the church. Do you go to church when you can? Do you remember what it was like? Do you remember the people there? Not all of us are attractive. Not all of us are even nice. The church is feeble. Paul writes that God chose what is foolish in the world. I don't like to hear that. God chose what is foolish in the world to shame the wise. God chose what is weak in the world to shame the strong. God chose what is low and despised in the world, even things that are nothing, to bring to nothing things that are, so that no human being might boast in the presence of God. Satan looks at the church and thinks, feeble. He looks at Christ on the cross and thinks, feeble. He looks at Samuel and David and Elijah and he thinks, feeble. You can be sure that Satan was laughing all the way to the cross on Good Friday. But you can also be sure that Satan was crying in anguish of defeat all the way from the empty tomb. That's the first question. Second question, will they restore it for themselves? He's talking about the city. He's talking about Jerusalem. Will they restore it? He's mocking them. Will you bring about the restoration of Jerusalem yourself? In many ways, the task was beyond them, though they would complete it. But he's playing a game of psychological warfare. He's aiming to smash their morale. And he is focusing, it has to be said, on the physical challenge of rebuilding walls. But the restoration the Bible talks about was a restoration far grander than even Sanballat could ever imagine. It was promised by God to include the rebuilding of Jerusalem as a stepping stone to the building of the new Jerusalem. But God had intended that Jerusalem would be rebuilt, but more than that, that people would be restored to their relationship with God. And so you have God saying, the Lord himself saying, I will set up over them one shepherd, my servant David. I myself, the Lord, will be the shepherd of my sheep. Sanballat may mock them as feeble, but an angel of the Lord would appear to an insignificant peasant girl called Mary and say to Mary, behold, you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you shall call his name Yeshua. That is, Yahweh saves. You will call him by the personal name of the Lord. He will be great. He will be called the Son of the Most High. And the Lord God will give to him the throne of his father David, and of his kingdom there will be no end. Will they restore it? Well, they'll do their part, but God will restore his Jerusalem and will restore his people. How will he do that? Well, it's captured in the third question. Will they sacrifice? Will they sacrifice? Sacrifices were a means of being reconciled to God. Everybody knew that the Jews had a history of breaking covenant with God. Everybody knew that the Jews themselves believed that the sack of Jerusalem was a result of their disobedience to their God. Is he mocking their ability to find a sacrifice that will put away their sin and their disobedience? Their first parents were disobedient, Adam and Eve. Israel, the nation, was disobedient. Was there any sacrifice that could resolve the human problem of our separation from God as well as Israel's problem of separation from God? Of course, the answer was going to take place in the city where they were building. Today we know that we are reconciled to God by the death of his son. The feeble Jew who's hanging on the cross would give his life as a ransom for many. Through that feeble Jew, in him, we have redemption, even the forgiveness of our sins, and therefore reconciliation to God. Question 4. Will they finish in a day? Well, of course. He's mocking their zeal. He says, you're going about this as if you can do this job in a day. He is, of course, right. They wouldn't finish it in a day, though they were very quick at finishing it, it has to be said, and we'll see that in due course. But he was asking the right question. Maybe he'd heard the promises that Zechariah the prophet had made. You remember that Zechariah is around at the time that Ezra is around, and he's ministering at that period. We learned that from the book of Ezra. And so perhaps Zechariah's words were familiar to this man, Sanballat, because Zechariah had talked about restoration happening in a day. So here he's mocking them. Will your restoration happen in a day? Is your prophet that you claim is a prophet, is he truthful? Is he right? Does he have the truth? Will you prove it to be true? But he wasn't really reading Zechariah correctly, was he? What Zechariah is talking about is not the rebuilding of Jerusalem under Nehemiah. He's talking about God's plan to build new Jerusalem. And that will be accomplished in a day, in the day of the Lord. Zechariah says in Zechariah 14, shall a land be born in one day? Zechariah says, yes, it will. There shall be no more curse. Jerusalem shall dwell in security. Christ is building his Jerusalem, his church, and she will be complete one day. God himself will be with them. He will be their God, and he will wipe away every tear from their eye, and death shall be no more. Neither shall there be mourning, nor crying, or pain anywhere. In a day, the day is coming, the day of resurrection. Here's how it's put in Zechariah 12. And the Lord will give salvation to the tents of Judah first, that the glory of the house of David and the glory of the inhabitants of Jerusalem may not surpass that of Judah. On that day, the Lord will protect the inhabitants of Jerusalem so that the feeblest among them on that day shall be like David, and the house of David shall be like God, like the angel of the Lord going before them. And on that day, God will give salvation. Well, the fifth question, very quickly. Will they revive the stones out of the heaps of rubbish? The builders had to use the stones of the old wall that had been demolished by the Babylonians. Would they be able to be used? There's a mockery here. Maybe he's mocking their ability to move the stones. There aren't many of them. We know that from the builders, among the builders, there's a bunch of daughters of one of the guys. Perhaps he's pointing to them and saying, do you think these women are going to be able to lift those boulders? He's mocking their ability to do this. And so he's saying, can you make these boulders live? Can you revive the stones? But here's the thing. In using this very image of bringing life into the stones, he is recalling two great images of the scriptures with respect of Christ and his people. That Christ is the foundation stone, the one rejected by the builders who's become the head of the corner. And his people are made alive by the Holy Spirit, so that as we come to him like living stones rejected by men, but in God's sight chosen and precious, so that like living stones, we are being built into a spiritual house to be a holy priesthood, to offer spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ our Lord. The New Jerusalem is built on the foundation of the apostles and the prophets, with Christ Jesus himself as the chief cornerstone. And we are living stones, made alive, brought to life by the power of God in that new Jerusalem? Well, that's all his questions. There's always somebody in the ready, of course, to make some smart remark, and that's what you have in verse 3. Tobiah the Ammonite was beside him. Again, these guys can't speak on their own behalf. They've got to have their mates with them before they talk. Tobiah the Ammonite was beside them, and he said, yes, what they're building, if a fox goes up in it, it will fall down. Well, of course, the wall that Nehemiah built, we know, I think it was Professor Kenyon back in the 70s who unearthed it in her work in Jerusalem. She unearthed Nehemiah's wall. It was 8 feet thick. So even that physical wall couldn't collapse. But, of course, ultimately it's not that city of Jerusalem that is in view. It is the ultimate city of Jerusalem that is in view. John says this, he carried me away in the spirit to a great high mountain and showed me the holy city, Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, having the glory of God, its radiance like the most rare jewel, like a jasper clear as crystal. It had a great high wall with 12 gates, and at the gates 12 angels. On the gates the names of the 12 tribes of the sons of Israel. On the east, 3 gates, and on the north, 3 gates, to the south, 3 gates, on the west, 3 gates, and the wall of the city had 12 foundations, and on them were the 12 names of the 12 apostles of the Lamb. The church, under siege by Satan and all his works, remains even now the pillar and bulwark, the fortress of the truth. It is the church of the living God. There's coming a day when the moon will be confounded and the sun ashamed. For the Lord of hosts shall reign on Mount Zion and in Jerusalem. And before his elders he will manifest his glory. He will manifest his glory in that new Jerusalem towards which we move and for which we pray. So here we are. We find ourselves attacked by enemies, by gossip, slander, being maligned, and so on. But behind those human enemies is the enemy of our souls. But we don't listen to the devil. We listen to God. We listen to his word. We put our trust in that word. That word above all earthly powers. We put our trust there because that word will last forever. Father, we pray that you would give us confidence in the word of Christ that saves us and that you give us confidence in the fact that our Christ has overcome the devil. He has crushed him under his feet, made a public display of his weakness at the cross. And one day he has promised us he will crush Satan under our feet shortly. In his name we pray. Amen.